Hi, my name is Brent, and today we're going to be converting a Miller CP-300 welder from three-phase to single-phase. I picked this unit up on Facebook Marketplace the other day. I was looking for a large MIG welder because currently I'm using a Hobart Handler 140, which is a perfectly adequate machine, but not for what I would like to do. This is what you get for 500 bucks these days. A Miller S22A wire feeder. It's a very basic unit. Just has just the feed and that's about it. None of the extra features. Here's the base unit. It's a CP300 constant voltage DC arc welding power source. The duty cycle on is 100%, which I really like. And judging by the date codes, the welder is a 1993 unit and the wire feeder is a 1994 unit. The welder does come with wheels, but I took them off because I was transporting on my trailer. The wire feeder is all there and it did even come with a regulator. I'll be probably using a 75-25 mix for most things. Nice long cable, good quality, good size cable. It's a three-phase plug, and I'm going to be buying the three-phase receptacle, but using it for single phase. The amperage on it is plenty high enough, so that's not a concern. Got your grounding strap, got a Bernard 045 welder, and I'd like to set this up for 035 wire, so I've just swapped the tip, but I may also have to swap out the liner as well. We'll see if I have issues with it. All right, so now we're about to clean this out. I'm basically going to be using a little air gun to blow it off, shop vac, and some Zep heavy-duty citrus degreaser for the reason why it was at my hardware store when I went to buy it. So we just gave it a wipe down, just mostly because I'm going to be touching this a lot, especially the inside, and my hands will get filthy. I'll put the filth on the electronics, and that doesn't really help much. So I'm going to pop the side covers off now, and then we'll clean out the inside, because I already had the side covers off this for a moment just to see what it was inside, and yeah, it's pretty bad. Side. If you're lucky, the original wire diagram is still on the inside. Try to, you know, take care to keep it clean and tidy, and when you're done with it, I'll show you the updated wiring diagram so you can put that here so the next guy that has this welder isn't totally screwed over when he tries to hook it up to three-phase. There to be dumped off or to be seen again. This is the guts of the welder. This is right here is where you're going to be doing most of your modification. If your unit is older or a CP200, it may not have the 200 volt tap. What that means is that you have to do a slightly different sequence of events. There'll be a PDF in the links below that'll show you how to do it. It'll also mean that you'll have to do the contactor mod, as it's called, as well. That's just part of the process. When you're working behind this though, there's jumpers on the backside that all have to be removed, but these are solid wires coming off the transformers and they will not take being bent back and forth. They will crack and you can have very strange and intermittent heat related issues with your welder as a result. So we're gonna come around the other side, and the other thing you should do while you're in here is this right down there is what adjusts the voltage of the welder. So there's the crank on the front, and if I can, there we go. The crank on the front cranks up and down. And if you look in the back, what you're doing is you're moving these back and forth over that. And what happens over time is their corrosion builds up on that. You can see how that's pretty dirty. So we're definitely gonna give that a wipe with some Scotch-Brite. I got a, I got this red Scotch-Brite. I wish I had white, but this is what they had at the hardware store. So, and the other thing that's to be warned about is in here there's carbon brushes, and those can seize up as well, especially if the unit isn't used terribly often. And as you can see, I don't think this bad boy has gotten a whole lot of love in a whole long time. So we're probably gonna set up on the other side first and clean the inside of this out. For cleaning the inside, I might use a little bit of that degreaser, but spray it on the rag and not the electronics. And in areas where I think it might be sensitive, I got some Pertronics contact cleaner, or gunk contact cleaner, sorry. Again, it's what they had, and they had other electrical cleaner, but this stuff is pretty mild and it won't destroy your plastics, which is what I was concerned about. So we'll use this a little bit. I'm also not concerned with getting this perfectly clean on the inside, because at the end of the day, this is the shop it's gonna be in. And perfectly clean is, it's not really on the table. So let's get this cleaned up. Second side. Thank you. right, well, now that that whole thing is a lot cleaner, and it's not perfect, but that's not really what we're going for, we can get to the point where we're now looking at the adjuster. So I showed you the handle on the front before, turns this rod. There's also a chain that drives a second rod to drive all three wipers back and forth. The thing to be aware of is, again, this should be nice and clean, and we're going to clean that in a moment. And these, the brushes, I think you can see these a little bit better, up here should be free to move. So I'm just going to kind of pry at them a little bit. I imagine there's a 1, 2, 3, 4, and you can't see 5 and 6, and then 3 wires connected to them. I imagine if you disconnected all 3 of those, and those 6 smaller screws, you get that right out there if you had any problems with it. Seeing as on this one I can see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 lines from it dragging back and forth, I'm not overly concerned at the moment. So right now I just gotta crank it all the way to the other side. And there we go, to the stop. And we're just gonna get in here and just clean that up. Oh, sorry. And that's starting to be just a little bit better, but you're gonna want the whole thing to have that nice copper shine on it. So we'll spend a little more time on that if I can get in there a little bit better. And you guys can just watch the back of my hand here for a minute, apparently. I don't know if it matters or not, but I'd probably just do the last couple swipes up and down. That little corner right there is gonna want, oh geez, everything's going to hell. All right, there we go. This is all gonna get fasted up anyways, because quite frankly, who would wanna watch this in real time? All right, wow, that one was really crusty. I'm pretty sure we would have had some sort of issues with this if we hadn't have done this. And it might have ranged from, you know, certain voltages, you just don't get quite as much pop and pow and zing and zowie. Or, you know, sometimes it might not work at all. And, you know, this does not take long enough to not do it, quite frankly. So there you go. You definitely absolutely do not want to use sandpaper for this operation, because you'll just damage things. You're just trying to take the layer of oxide off the surface is really all you're doing. So alrighty. And if I wasn't doing this as a video, you could be damn sure I'd only be doing this after it failed to work right, but why not try doing it right for once, just in case. All right, and now that's pretty decent, and then we got to crank it all the way back over. I would probably not put any lubrication on this, despite the fact that it looks like it might do it some good. I just suspect that it'll draw more dust and dirt, and especially since this is going to be near metal dust a lot, you're way more likely to damage something, I think, than you are to make it any better. So, yeah, crank it some more. All the way to the stop. All the way to the stop. Okay. Now we're going to reposition. Go over to this side, and my GoPro does not have a viewfinder, so it is somewhat luck of the draw what you guys can see. So, and then you can see the area I cleaned and the area I didn't. So we're just gonna go just scrub that down. especially where there's little green meanies up there, you want those gone or pretty close. Yeah, that's better. You don't want to scrub this area or this area so much. You don't really want to take any more insulation off of it than it already has. So we're just gonna, I'm gonna get some more Scotch Brights, what we're gonna do, because that stuff's pretty wore out. All right. Yeah, definitely some liquid got in here and got a little cooked at some point in time, I'd say, but not that that's a big deal. Just want it all nice and clean. So, and you can actually see on this one, you can see where the carbon's dragged across where I've just done it, and there's some reasonably good contact there. So I think on the whole, I think we're just fine. Just get that bottom one a little bit, and that should make the difference. Again, none of this is my own information per se. I read a thread. This is one thing they mentioned you might have problems with, and it seemed like to me, like an ounce of prevention, especially during the cleaning process, is worth a pound of cure. So, if we're gonna look through, we're gonna look right through the middle of this now, because I see that we can see the back side of that. And if I can get this positioned, you'll see down here, you'll see this wire and this wire, and those are jumpers up to there and there. Those are going to have to come off as well. Basically, everything off the back is going to come off, and you're going to have to rewire those for the purpose of, you know, changing from three phase to single phase. And also, you're going to have to make sure the fan motor is wired up to power, because I think if you leave it where it is, it will not get the power that it needs to thrive. So, in any case, until I get the capacitors, that's where we're going to leave off for today. So, you know, have a good day, and yeah, we'll see what happens.